చూసే మనం
ప్రొఫెసర్
ఏం చెప్తాం అనుకోండి ది కోఆర్డినేటర్ ఆఫ్ ద సెషన్ ప్రేమ్ కుమార్ అండ్ ఐ కో ప్యానలిస్ట్ ప్రమోద్ కుమార్ ఐ రియలీ కాంగ్రాచులేట్ ఫస్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఆల్ మోతిలాల్ నెహ్రూ కాలేజ్ అండ్ ద కాంప్లెక్స్ ఇస్ ది ఈవినింగ్ So, let me also say that it's an easy one for me. I congratulate Mr. Motilal Nehru for being part of this institute and its Ambedkar Circle for organizing such a thought-provoking seminar. And also the topic, as Manfredi has just said, that yeah, there is a legacy, there is something which is historical, that is something which has to be evaluated, and that's why we are trying to revisit. Revisit, and that too, we are trying to revisit the multiple dimension of Baba Saheb Ambedkar. That is that we have already accepted that there are multiple dimensions. I think this seminar also establishes that. So I congratulate the organizers. I also like to thank my personal thank to Dr. Ashwani for giving me this opportunity, because Ashwani, though, is a good friend, but giving somebody a dais means something. I know that how our colleagues fight that they should be given a space, they should be given an audience. So I know that you should have also fought, you should have also contested. So I congratulate that Motilal Nehru has given me, a college has given me this opportunity and dais to speak. Friends, my topic of the paper is a framework to understand Dr. Ambedkar's thought and philosophy. So I want to propose a framework. Why I want to do this? Why I want that there should be a framework to understand? Because till now, Baba Saheb Ambedkar has been understood only as a person who has written on Dalits, or he has written only on caste. That has been, or some people try to evaluate his contribution to the constitution. So one, on the one hand, we know that he has written on caste, and therefore people write on caste, and otherwise people try to evaluate him through constitutional expert. Rest is actually somewhere blacked out, and that's why I thought that there should be a framework, not to reduce Baba Saheb Ambedkar, let us enlarge him. As far as academics is concerned, I don't want to deal him here as a political leader. I want to make my students and teachers here to understand him as an academician. And that is why my framework is very different. So in this framework, what I try to argue that I want to locate Baba Saheb's thought. When did he start? The real historical moment when he started producing the knowledge. What was the Then I come to understand what is the type of knowledge which he produced. Was it some speculative philosophy? Was it something like a conjectural understanding? Or what is really referential knowledge, referential objective knowledge which he produced through texts, writing through books, writing through journals, writing through newspapers? So I just want to understand Baba Saheb Ambedkar through the academic lens, and that too, if I try to look at him, when did he start writing? When was his first article published? It was 1915 when he wrote his MA dissertation as a student of Columbia University. I'm not going to the title, but he published his first article as an MA student in an international journal, and that was Indian Antiquary. It was published in 1917, 102 years ago. The second article in journal was published in 1918, and he went on to evaluate the small holdings in India and their remedies. So it is again a very perceptible understanding. His PhD dissertation in Columbia University came in 1916, and his another PhD dissertation came in 1920 in London School of Economics. Then in 1919 he wrote a reference, a representation to South Borough Committee, and that representation had lots of references,
empirical data, factual data. And last but not the least, he started bringing out Mooknayak in 1920s. So I'm giving you the shades of the writing that he was trying to produce. He was not giving lectures. Bhashan dekar ke knowledge nahi produce kiya. He wrote article with the references. And that's why we as academicians should celebrate. Yahan par abhi aayega log bolega are unhone ye kar diya wo kar diya aise nahi chalega. I am trying to argue that let us take out an academician out of Baba Saheb Ambedkar. And that's why I am trying to give you this reference. The second part of my article is epistemology of Baba Saheb Ambedkar. Epistemology means the source and foundation of knowledge. Isko agar Hindi mein aap kahein to gyan mimansa, unke gyan ke utpadan ki mimansa. क्या उनके स्रोत थे इसको मैं लेकर के यहां पर बात करना चाहता हूं. We all know that he had three influences, Buddha, Kabir and Jyotiba Phule. These were the three sources he had, but these were philosophical sources. And we all know that Baba Saheb Ambedkar's early childhood went through Kabir bhajan, sabhangs, and not Kabir of Ramanand, but the Nandana tradition of Maratha. So we have different traditions of Kabir, and therefore when Ramji comes in his name, it is not Ram of Ayodhya, not Ram of Dasratha, but Ram of Kabir. So we have to understand that as well. Thirdly, of epistemology is that what type of sources which he used. And if you see, there are 11 sources which I have tried to trace in his articles, in his books, in his writings. You can begin his sources from archaeology, archaeological sources, archival sources, Indological sources, then books, journals, of course these were of course there, but government reports, commission reports, then we have encyclopedias, at least 9 types of encyclopedia he used to write. And paper clippings from Times of India to his own types of book view. That is what actually he was producing. Book knowledge from the foreign sources becomes a very important epistemological source for his production of knowledge. Therefore, we should engage with Baba Saheb Ambedkar not as a political leader only. He was an academician. That's what I want actually to present here. The fourth point as far as his epistemology is concerned. If you take, participation, his experiences. So at least 6 shades of experiences of his life, from childhood experience to experience as a student in foreign university, and then as a professional in India, having exclusion, suffering from exclusion, and then becoming an advocate, then coming to Viceroy Council and also becoming the chairman of the drafting committee, and also the first law minister of the country. So see 6 sources of experiential reality. Last but not the least, the experiential reality of the movement which he led, number of movement. And I'm really reminded of Satyagrahas, because Satyagrahas are only equated with one personality in India. It is not only that he was leading Satyagraha. Ambedkar Satyagraha was on his own original idea. Though Gandhi took Satyagraha from Thoreau, but Ambedkar did not take it from Thoreau, but it was also from Buddha. So there are different sources and foundations of the knowledge system. That's what I want to argue. Let us come to the approaches. How many approaches Baba Saheb Ambedkar has incorporated to produce his knowledge? This is very important for students, because students may read Baba Saheb Ambedkar in a linear manner. It is not that we have to read Baba Saheb Ambedkar only in linear manner. We have to look into the typologies which he evolved to understand. And this is one I found historical approach in Baba Saheb Ambedkar's understanding. He goes to the origin of the institutions. When he wants to understand caste, he goes to its institution. When he wants to understand religion, he goes to its origin. So that historical approach is very, very sine qua none in his production of knowledge. Equated with historical approach, there is also evolutionary approach. And you all know evolutionism started with Darwin, and Darwin gave this evolutionism in biology, but it was brought into sociology. And Ambedkar, being a student of ethnology at that time, as in Colombia sociology was known as, he became a student of evolutionism, and that's when he started producing his knowledge through the perspective of evolution. I give you this example. When he was trying to understand religion, how did he understand? He did not go directly to understand what is the function of religion. No, he went into the evolution of religion. And when he was looking at evolution of religion, he tried to understand whether what are the components of religion. He tried to understand theology as the component of religion and ritualism as the another component of the religion. And within theology, he tried to look the two types of different theology. One, in Greek mythology, there are two types of theologies. One is mythological theology and another is civil theology. So he starts understanding religion through the evolutionary perspective. And then he goes to Max Müller and tries to find out how many types of religion exist in the world. Max Müller had made a typology of 10 religions, but he did not, you know, adhere to Max Müller. Rather, he started talking about, no, if you compress the religion, then you will find there are two types of religion in the world. One is revealed religion and another is book religion. And having compared the two, then he comes to analyze what is the type of religion Hinduism is. And not only that, friends, you know, I'm intrigued that when he was trying to understand religion, he went on to compare it with Dhamma. What is the difference between Dhamma and religion? I think some of the very, very important elements which, as a sociologist, he was trying to analyze. Not only that, he goes on to analyze and compares Buddhism and Marxism. Buddha or Karl Marx. This is a full-blown comparison. And then he tries to compare what is the basic elements of Buddhism and what is the basic element of Marxism. And can it be compared the two? Can we compare the two? Because, you know, Marx and Buddha, they are actually separated for 2,500 years. So how can you compare the two things? Because they are two pole apart. But he said that no, there is a commonality in philosophy. Let us take out that commonality. And he brings out the commonality. I'm not going into detail because we have to cover a little bit. But he argues that what is the difference between Buddhism and Marxism? And he found two very important differences. One was that Buddhism never preaches violence as a way of revolution. Social revolution, political revolution will always be a peaceful means, through peaceful means. Second, he tried to argue that Buddhism always believes in democracy. But Marxism, of his variety, what he studied, preaches violence and also leads to dictatorship of proletariat. Where he differed. That was the difference. We can talk a little bit later. But that was where I'm trying to argue that evolutionism became a very important perspective in Ambedkar's production of knowledge. The third perspective which he uses is comparative perspective. He tries to compare the entities. He doesn't produce knowledge singularly on a linear path. Rather, he tries to compare the institutions. And this comparison can come, and if you really want to understand, take example of untouchability. When he was trying to understand untouchability, he tries to compare it with slavery. And within slavery, he tries to compare Roman slavery with American slavery. How these slaveries were different and how this slavery is different from untouchability. And then he concludes. So there is a comparison. Also, when he was trying to compare the untouchability, he compares the three types of societies. One is ancient society, and before that he goes to primitive society, and then comes to the modern society. For him, he was comparing that, look, there was a primitive society, there is an ancient society, and there is modern society. So if you really want to understand untouchability, then we have to compare all these three epochs and then analyze whether untouchability existed in primitive society, or the untouchables existed in primitive society or not. So this is a very, very important contribution as far as the Indian history is concerned. The another comparative perspective example can be taken when he was trying to understand the revolutions, social revolutions and political revolutions. And he compared Indian independence, after Indian independence, when India got freedom, what was the role of the elites in this revolution? And how elites have tried to understand the institutions and whether they are willing to give up their power or not. That was the beginning point. Then he goes to compare it with French Revolution. And within French Revolution, he talks about what is the level of the elites, what are the contribution of the elites. You know, French society was divided into three groups. There were nobility, there was clergy, and there were commoners. And when French Revolution took place, the clergy, the commoners, and the nobility, they came together and gave up their rights, and therefore democracy was born. Then he comes to Japan. In Japan, he was trying to look who were the people who were contributing. And there he saw that samurai and daimyos, they were the two leading communities. They were the higher classes. Daimyos were the land-holding class. And the samurai, they were the, of course, the higher classes. And then Eta was the commoners. So when the Japanese Revolution took place, all these three groups came together and they gave up their rights to the king and said that decide. This is Baba Saheb Ambedkar writing. That decide basically that whether what is fit for the society, you should start contributing to the nation. And that's why we see Japan where it is today. But when it came to India, what has happened? In India, the elites have tried to monopolize the power. They have tried to monopolize economic, political, social, education, all the powers. And when we ask, when the deprived classes ask their representation, there is no space for them. And we see today, if you go and analyze what is the composition of the today's cabinet, you will realize whether there is representation of the community or not. So therefore, friends, the comparative perspective of Baba Saheb Ambedkar becomes a very potent idea of production of knowledge, which is scientific in nature. So, having given you the locating, when did he start producing the knowledge? Second, what is the epistemology, source and foundation of his knowledge? Third, what is the perspective with which he has produced knowledge? Let us come to the nature and the scope of his knowledge. Because there is also a process of reductionism, that Baba Saheb is written only on caste, and therefore caste, annihilation of caste is the real production of knowledge. Thus, nothing is there. So I am intrigued by this scholarship. I want to call my young people, young generation, read Baba Saheb Ambedkar's in collective perspective. Don't read him his retrospective. Don't get bogged down by the blackout which he has suffered. You all know how blackout has happened from literary texts, even the creative text. A film like Gandhi did not show even in one frame Baba Saheb Ambedkar. There was total blackout from Gandhi. Now you will say, sir, why one should show Baba Saheb Ambedkar in Gandhi? Oh, it was film on Gandhi, therefore actually Gandhi was everywhere. So I will ask another question, that if Gandhi was, if Baba Saheb Ambedkar was not relevant in Gandhi, how Gandhi becomes relevant in Baba Saheb Ambedkar? When Jabbar Patel produces, well, Gandhi is in every frame. Why? So if we cannot even evaluate Baba Saheb Ambedkar on an independent basis. And that's why I think we as an academician should look into the production of knowledge and the shades of production of knowledge. That's where my fourth point is. And when I start looking
And I don't want to go in detail, but I will definitely put you at least, I look 10 shades of academic knowledge production. And with reference, it is not that Bhashan de diya kisi ne, aur abhi aayenge kuch log, aap dekhenge, Baba sahab ne jo hai, wo reserve bank bana diya, Baba sahab ne jo hai, census kar diya, Baba sahab ne rihan bandh ki. ये सब बातें नेताओं को अच्छी लगती है लेकिन सेमिनार में ताली नहीं बजती अपने भाषण में ताली बजती मैं ये कहना चाह रहा था कि when as a student, when as a teacher, we produce knowledge. How do we do? We do it with research. We do it with reference. We do it with logic. We do it with theories. We do it with method. Here is that production of knowledge. Why Baba Sahib Ambedkar is not being evaluated? And that's why in 21st century, when we revisit Baba Sahib Ambedkar, we have to look into the theory, the method, the philosophy, the logic, as well as the empirical data which he has included. And that's why I'm trying to give a typology. The paper is not complete, but this is the only first time I'm reading, but I have worked a little bit on this. So coming to the shades of knowledge, I look at least 10 shades of empirical knowledge which he has, and now there are 21 volumes of Baba Sahib writing and his speeches in English. In English, there may be Hindi translation, Urdu translation, even Uriya, the Tamil, Kannad, Punjabi, there have been translations. But if you do not get the book, please go on to website. The volumes, 21 volumes are on website. If you want to take the address, please go to www.mea.government.in. You will get the writings there. They are free, of course. You can download and read. So my humble submission will be like this. Now, coming to the shades of knowledge, as I said, that one of the important shades, of course, is the production of the social knowledge. And I, within this social knowledge, I start with, of course, caste as one of the important institutions, and from caste to village and to the social movement. This is the terrain with which Baba Sahib Ambedkar argues that production of knowledge. Now, within caste, I think we should not restrict to Baba Sahib Ambedkar to caste, because the most important production of knowledge is Hindu social order. If you look into the Hindu social order, Baba Sahib is a rare sociologist, I will argue, that he has tried to argue for the first time in India place of the individual in the Hindu social order. No sociologist talks about place of individual. What is the place of vyakti ka pure bhartiya samaj aur dharm ke andar, Hindu dharm ke andar, uski prasthiti kya? What is the status of the individual? Whether he has a right or not, whether he has something more than independent rights or not, nobody talks about. Baba Sahib Ambedkar says that Hindu social order, in his two very important articles, essential features of Hindu social order and unique features of Hindu social order. Look into that. I think you will be very easily getting it. The second aspect of Hindu social order is the structure of Hindu social order. Usually we are taught that Hindu society is divided into four varnas. That is the beginning of the understanding was. Baba Sahib Ambedkar takes a very different view, and let me tell you, he classifies the society first into two groups. One is Vaidika and another is Dasya. This is the first division he brings in. And then he comes to, Vaidikas are divided into four groups. Those who are in Chaturvarna, those who are outside Chaturvarna, third is Vratya, and fourth is Patit. Now within the outcast, then he goes on to talk about that they are definitely subdivided into Anulomas and Pratilomas. So this is a very unique type of categorization
Then he comes to origin of Varna and the Shudra. And he is not taking from Rig Veda. He is talking about also from Athar Veda. He uses here a methodology which is called as linguistic methodology. The meter. What is the meter of Rig Veda, Puru Sukta, 10th Mandal, where this whole Varna hierarchy is described? Then he goes on to talk about origin of development of caste, and then comes to untouchables, and then comes to untouchable people. This is the structure of the Hindu social order, not the caste. So don't reduce him to the caste. The second thing which I want to is the constitutionalism which people talk about, and I think it is very important that Baba Sahib should be talked about democracy and constitution together, because people are talking about democracy is one which consists of a constitution and then adult suffrage, and third thing they say is a parliamentary form of government. That is what is democracy. Baba Sahib very rightly analyzed this, that okay, if you say that democracy is only these three institutions, why did democracy fail in Italy? Why did democracy fail in Germany? Why did democracy fail in Russia? Why actually there have been revolutions? And therefore, Ambedkar says that there is beyond this adult suffrage, beyond the constitutional morality, there is something else. And then we come that it is basically the self-representation of the people. Self-representation becomes the hallmark of the democracy. Swapratinidhitva. Satta ki sansthaon mein, shiksha ki sansthaon mein, sansadhan ki sansthaon mein swapratinidhitva nahi hai, to wo jo prajatantra hai, wo prajatantra rukega nahi, log isko todenge. I think this was something very unique analysis of democracy, which I do not find in many. Coming to the constitution, Ambedkar, when he was trying to produce constitution, and he said that I have tried to look into American constitution, Australian constitution, South African constitution, Canadian constitution, Ireland constitution, and so on and so forth. And then he goes on to say that, what is the structure of our constitution? And where actually we stand together. So people were criticizing that, whether this constitution will stand test of the time or not. That was the basic question which was asked to him again and again. Kya yeh samvidhan sabhi samay ke liye sahi baithega? Ambedkar was very polite in replying that, look, how can I vouch for the future? A constitution is the collective wisdom of the people of the time, and it is the collective wisdom of the time of that people of that time. So it is the people, because a constitution can only provide you institutions. A constitution can provide you institutions. How those institutions? And institutions are usually lifeless. They do not have life. It is the people who are running those institutions. And therefore he argued that if the people, howsoever bad a constitution is, if the people are in the right earnest, bad constitution will prove to be a good constitution. And howsoever good constitution is, if the people are bad, even good constitution will turn to bad. And therefore I cannot vouch. It will depend upon the future generations. How do they run the institution? And counting it, he said that what we lack is constitutional morality. And constitutional morality is one that is respecting the opposition also like your own self. If you do not respect, then you are gone. So there should be a space for dissent. That was the constitutional morality is all about. India lacks constitutional morality. If we lack constitutional morality, how can constitution run? Because constitution, as I have just told you, it gives you institution. If the majority of the population is opposing a law, what can constitution do? Because you cannot stop. And that is why he argued that he added social justice along with equality, liberty and fraternity. He added that epithet that was social justice. And taking leave from many other constitutions, he tried to argue that self-representation of the people, at least in different institutions, will further strengthen the Indian democracy. If that is not given, people have tried to argue that why self-representation is so important. And Ambedkar wrote in his Southborough Committee representation that if a government is a space, if a government is a space to harness the capacity and capability of the individual, then everybody should get a space in that government. Otherwise, people will not be able to harness their capability and capacity. How they will harness it, and therefore you should get a space. The second aspect is, therefore he argued, a good government is that which does not only give representation of aspirations to the people. Oh, humne aapki ban marzi samajh li hai, aap baithiye, hum aapke liye kanun bana denge, hum aapki aakanchhaen samajhte hain. आकांक्षाओं का प्रतिनिधित्व करने वाली सरकार अच्छी सरकार नहीं होती। बाबा साहब ने कहा, a good government is not that gives only representation to the aspiration. A good government is that which gives self-representation to the people. And second, why self-representation should be there? Ambedkar argued that if we are really trying to make a democracy, if we are trying to develop a democracy in this society, in Indian society, there are certain people who are rulers or those who have remained rulers forever, and there are people who are ruled. Now, if you do not change the situation and if you give the others only the representation, that the rulers will be keep on making rule for the ruled. So, Raja hamesa Raja rahega aur Rank hamesa Islie, those who are ruled, they should also be given opportunity to frame the laws for the others. Then and then only democracy will arrive. If you do not give the space for the ruled, there will not be a democracy. Ruled will also be ruled and rulers will always remain ruler. Therefore, this pattern should change the hand. Last but not the least, Ambedkar quoted Gopal Krishna Gokhale. Ambedkar quoted for Gopal Krishna Gokhale for representation. And Gopal Krishna Gokhale in 1885 had given a representation to British government. British government at that time, Britannia Samraj ki sarkar ko unhone gyapan diya. Ye kehte hue gyapan diya ki Britannia Samraj ki sarkar mein भारतीयों की अनदेखी हो रही, there is no representation for Indians, people are not getting representation and therefore dwarfing and stunting of the Indian is taking place. Indians are not able to achieve their total manhood, they are not able to harness their capability and capacity. Ambedkar drew a straight line. Oh, Gopal Krishna Gokhale ji, India, British has come only 150 years back. And within 150 years, you have lost all your capability and capacity. Within 150 years, you have lost all your total manhood. You are not able, you are being dwarfed. You see us, you have not given us representation for thousands of years. And therefore, friend, Baba Saheb Ambedkar, on moral ground, asked for self-representation. Self-representation has been reduced to poverty alleviation today. That is the difference when we do not read, you know, our thinkers. We try to understand self-representation is equivalent to reservation. It was not. What is reservation today is totally different philosophy altogether. It is a poverty alleviation program. I keep on telling that economic upliftment program which you have just made, it is basically Manrega. Manrega is there.
if you want to elevate from poverty, please send them to Manrika. There's nothing to give reservation. And that to 8 lakh of rupees is poverty line. So there is totally, you know, differential reason. Arre baith jao yaar, thodi der, bhai. Okay, ma'am, okay. So there are actually other arguments which I think sometimes if you call me one to one, then I can come and present. But right now, my urge to young student is only try to look Baba Saheb Ambedkar as an entity who is fit case to be understood in a university. A entity as a student. If you look at his life as a student, how much achievement, a higher level of achievement he had despite handicaps. So a student come and tell us, oh sir, we have this handicap, that handicap. I don't buy that argument. I try to argue that look Baba Saheb Ambedkar and get motivated that despite handicaps, despite social hurdles, you can come up. Second, he goes and have the American education and then has foreign education. But he doesn't stay there. He comes back and tries to serve the country. He becomes teacher. He becomes lawyer. But he doesn't run away from the responsibility of the nation. When the nation gave him a responsibility, he took this responsibility despite, in spite of the oppositions, in spite of, you know, unsocial atmosphere which existed, despite the fact he took up the responsibility for the sick heck of nation, and therefore he become a nation builder as such. So I think let us read Baba Saheb Ambedkar in totality and as an academician, not as a politician. Thank you so much.